Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about copyright law. This is for work on my assignment, Unit 2 Copyright, which is part of the Creative Commons Certificate for Educators and Librarians. Recording this on June 21st. This presentation's on my speaker deck. I'll link to that and in the notes of the video and all the other references as well. They're actually linked at the bottom of the presentation. So this is the Section 2 Copyright Law in this course, which is also CC BY. Of course. So let's go to the first slide. So a little bit of history and background. 1710 in England, an act for the encouragement by learning by vesting the copies of printed books in the authors or purchases of such copies during the times therein mentioned. This law gave book publishers 14 years of legal protection for the copying their books by others. There's the reference there at Avalon Law, Yale Edu. And so the idea is that we wanted inventors, or well, not inventors, more creators of works to be motivated to release their works so people can use them, but giving them protections so that they would be able to benefit from the sharing of their works. So that's the idea behind this, right? So let's just go over this a little bit. It's mainly in section 2.1. So here's the idea that the copyright grants a set of exclusive rights. Again, this is section 2.1 from the course notes. And one thing we got to be careful with is who controls the rights. If you're working for a company, if it's put you in a situation sometimes of work for hire, and you got to check the legal, even if you are contracting for someone, what's the contract saying in terms of a work that's created, who owns the work? Is it the company that's paying you or the person is creating the rights? So you got to be a little bit careful about whether you have the copyright or not. Remember that Creative Commons certificates and Creative Commons licenses are built on top of copyright, and you need to own that copyright to be able to put a Creative Commons license on top of that. Also important to know that it doesn't protect facts or ideas. We'll talk about this in another slide, but it's an automatic thing. So when you create it, when you put it down, it's actually created, and then it lasts a long time. I'll mention that as well in my slides. There's a history of copyright. I'll link this here in a second. I think I actually have it up on the next slide. Yeah, so it's up on the next slide. Fixed copyright created this video called Copy, also known as Copyright, tells a story of his life. It's right here, and I'll just play first couple seconds. I don't want to do too much there.
I was the unsung of a mum and dad, but I'll get to those guys.
And there's no sound shared, actually, so I forgot to share the sound. But this is an excellent video. It's 9 minutes long that really gives you a history of what the story was behind the creation of copyright. So I recommend that you share that. We should also be aware of the license on those YouTube videos. And you can see here, if you go to a YouTube video, we're viewing it, and I know, and you don't want to go down to the comments, but luckily there's comments turned off here. Sometimes you do. But here's, if you go to the show more, show less, we're going to see that this is actually licensed under a Creative Commons license and reuse allowed. It doesn't tell us which version, which CC license, but if we go into the details, this is YouTube help information. It lets us know that it's created by a CC BY license, and we got to do another click through here to see actually what's going on. Some instructions here about you shouldn't be putting things under a CC license if you don't have the right to, because you don't have the copyright. And so it's linking to CC BY 3.0. So technically any of your YouTube videos that you're choosing to release under a Creative Commons license is CC BY 3.0. Okay, and you can see that, say, on my videos. Almost all of them, at least the ones I can remember that I've checked, all of mine are also under Creative Commons attribution license as well. So back to the slide deck, there's the link to that video. Then we're going to talk about where, when, how does license, how long does the licenses last. Again, this is from the course of Creative Commons, Section 2.1 of Copyright Basics. So copyright's automatic, as we just saw. When the work is fixed in a medium, so when you write it down, when you record it, when something that we can point to is tangible and we can say that's when the copyright was created. Lasts a long time, often decades after the death of the creator. And the other thing that's really interesting is if, say, Ken creates a work in Mexico, but I'm actually a Canadian citizen, and then you're from Germany and you're traveling to Japan, and while in Japan, you're using my work, right? Which copyright law applies at the time. And it's usually the law says it's where the work is being used. So there's that to look at. To go through a little bit other things with copyright, there's the idea of utilitarian. The idea here is that we want to encourage new works, like I mentioned when I was reading off from the Statute of Anne. And then the author's rights, we want to grant rights to the authors and protect them of their choice of how their work is being used. Okay, so that's basically the idea here. What's copyrightable? Literary artistic works, translations, adaptations, collections of literary and artistic work, other things can be put with copyrights on it. Computer software, that's a series of lots of tension, but I won't get into that as a software engineer right here and right now today. What are the exclusive rights granted? Make authorized translations, make copies of the work, okay? Get exclusive rights, certain use of the works by others, such as the following. Make copies, translations that are authorized, public performances and communications, and adaptations, okay? Other thing that I want to point out as well is moral rights and the idea of neighboring rights. Neighboring rights are kind of like other copyright-like rights to not necessarily the creator of the work, but someone transmitting the work. So we could talk about communications, broadcasting, and things. The moral rights is also interesting. Even if I'm under a work for hire, there is a moral right that my institution might own the copyright on the work I created as part of my job, but there's a moral right that I should also be given credit as the person who actually created the work. So that's the other things I wanted to talk about there. And that about covers that slide. Okay, so let's go over to the next slide that I have wrote. I talked about moral rights, talked about neighboring rights, and then trademarks and patents. That's the next section here. Trademark law is a different area. It's not to do with copyrights. It's about the branding mainly, I guess, is like you recognize the arches for McDonald's or the swoop of Nike and other things like that. And then patents get into the use of patents that are put on tarps of implementations of work. And patent law is a completely different animal, really. So we won't go into that here today. And then what about that public domain thing? So we'll go through these sections. 6.2.2, global aspects. We talked a little bit about that with the example of Canadian and Mexico creating something and a German goes to Japan. Public domain. So some things actually get into this idea of public domain. Remember that the idea of copyright is to give grant the rights to the copyright holder for a long time, but that time is finite. So how do things get into the public domain and what does that mean? Well, it means that you can pretty much do what you want, sort of, kind of. You should still give credit, but what I really want to be talking about is how things get into the public domain. So the copyright could expire. That's one thing. And we've, you know, they last a long time, but they're going to expire eventually. The work was never entitled to copyright protection. So legalities of that, there wasn't really the legal case for it to be under copyright, not following the rules. The creator can actually choose to put things into the public domain. And that's another option. And the copyright holder filed a complaint with formalities. So you don't have the copyright. So therefore, it's not under copyright. Okay, what can you do with work? You can pretty well do anything else you want. Depends on the scope. It's all sorts of other issues involved here, but generally public domain means you can use it. One thing I want to talk about here is a friend of mine, Alan Levine, wrote an interesting post here. This is back in 2017. Are you looking at the opposite end of Creative Commons? Again, his blog post, if we look down at the end, released under a CC4 license. But I wanted to focus on this. It's an excellent post. I got it linked in the references. Always attribute. There it is. I found it. So Alan's point, and my point as well, Alan used to put a lot of his images under CC0 licenses. So under the public domain with a CC0 license. And we've talked about this a lot, that even if I don't have a legal responsibility to give credit, I should just always give credit. There's no reason not to give credit. Someone might find an image or something else I'm using my blog post. I might have the legal right to not have to credit to it if it's CC0 or a public domain image. But I should, because they might want to know, well, where's the original version of that? Who made it? And they want to go and dig deeper into it. I might be using a low resolution version of it, and they want to go find the original. So I actually believe in this heavily, and I really like that Alan talks a lot about this. I recommend following his blog and following his work. Another related to that in public domain is Alan's rant back about 5 years ago on It's Not Stealing, Please Stop Saying So. And he gets into the point that often, you know, I love that assignment idea you have. I'm going to steal it. I'm not really stealing it. I'm reusing it because you still have your idea. You still have your assignment. I'm using your thoughts and then recreating something for myself, even if it's going up to use in the actual implementation. But then we might want to look at the license on top of it. So I wanted to add that in as well at the end. So that covers public domain. The Berne Convention covers another set of agreements internationally between countries with copyrights. And so one of the things it covers is limitations and exceptions. Copyright's not absolute. I have a right to use certain things. So here we go. In the special cases, provided that such reproduction does not conflict with the normal exploitation of the work and does not unreasonably prejudice a legitimate interests of the author, which I think is what I quoted right here. And the idea here is there's the three-step test, which you can look into details, but how can you use a small piece or a referencing the original work without invading the rights and the copyright use of the author, but still allowing us to point to it, still allowing us to reference it, and in some cases still allowing to share parts of it in certain circumstances. So that's another really important thing to look at, and I invite you to dig deeper into that. Okay, so here's the references. There's the Avalon Lay, which talks about the Statute of Anne. A lot of this content that I was showing here while I was browsing through it is from the Copyright Law Unit 2 of the Creative Commons Certificate for Educators and Librarians, which is released under Creative Commons license. You can go and look at it. There's the link. It's not linking here on the slide, but that's okay. The link's there. CC4 as well. I'm referencing the date here. It's June 2020 course because this could change over time, the content, when you go see it. Copy, also known as copyright, that's the video I showed you a short clip of. This is my video just as a reference to see that I have the CC licenses on my own videos. And then the references to the both blog posts by my good buddy Alan Levine. And I hope this video wasn't too long, and I thank you for watching it, and I look forward to any feedback. Details, link to the slides and the other links in the comments, or not the comments below, the description below in the YouTube video. Thank you and have an excellent day.